I'd like to welcome everyone who's joined this panel discussion today, which in my view is going to be an exciting one because it's not every day that you have investors and investees on the same platform discussing a particular topic. Today we will be talking about the challenges that space startups face in India. And with me, we have four young entrepreneurs from different cities. We have two very experienced VCs as well. Let me start by giving all of you a quick introduction to the Indian space landscape. I won't be surprised if some of you aren't fully aware of where India stands internationally speaking when it comes to the world of space. So the first experimental launch happened in around 1963. From Tumba, which makes the Indian space program, if you ask me, one of the oldest space programs in the world. The Indian Space Research Organization was formally incorporated in 1972, I believe. And in my view, having worked with the Americans, the Europeans, the Japanese, the Russians, I would place India easily in the top six when you look at space capabilities and you look at budgets. So ISRO not only builds its own satellites, it has rockets for launching its Earth observation satellites and COMSATs as well. They're building the GSLV, which is the COMSAT launcher, and trying to take it to a higher tonnage. We are also now, as a country, engaging in planetary missions. We have sent orbiters to the moon, to Mars. We are looking at Venus. India has also been working on a human space program for almost 10 years now and is planning to launch humans into Earth orbit. Now, with all this, you would imagine that India plays a big role in the international space marketplace. But that hasn't been the case yet, I would say. So the space market annually, if you look at the civilian space market, not the defense side of things, is inching close to about $400 billion a year. And that includes launch vehicles, satellites, satellite applications, and also ground equipment. So the question that we need to ask ourselves as a panel, among others, is what will it take for India to become a significant player in this international market? And with that, I think I'll go ahead and introduce some of our young entrepreneurs first and have our VCs tell us in their introductory remarks about what their investment interests are in terms of their companies and themselves also. So we have with us today Avais Ahmed, who is the co-founder and CEO of Pixel, which is a Bangalore-based startup that's building a constellation of Earth observation satellites with a vision of creating a health monitor for our planet. Avais happens to be a graduate from BITS Pilani, and he was also the engineering lead for a very exciting team out of India, which was called Hyperloop India. It was one of many student and non-student teams around the world that developed subscale prototypes to demonstrate the Hyperloop idea that Elon Musk has. We also have with us Srinath. I think you can also raise your hands a bit so the audience knows who we are talking about. That was a bias for you. Srinath Ravichandran. Srinath has interesting background. He has degrees in electrical and aerospace engineering. He also has a finance background, and he worked as a Wall Street trader for some time before he chose to return to India and start his company, Agniku. Agniku is a company that is building a rocket to launch small satellites. And I think it's very interesting to have people who also go out, work for some time, and come back and choose to become entrepreneurs. Avais, on the other hand, has gone straight from graduate school into entrepreneurship. We have with us Devleena Bhattachari from Bombay. Devleena happens to be a very experienced data scientist with more than 15 years of experience. And her first data science startup was a risk intelligence platform for the insurance industry. And now she has a second data science startup, which is called Numa 8. And it is using satellite data, a very good example of how our space assets help improve life on Earth. And she's building analytics in order to make it possible for us to have a profitable and sustainable seafood industry. We also have with us another young entrepreneur, Yashas Karana. Yashas is the co-founder of Bellatrix, and he heads operations, strategy, business for Bellatrix. What's cool about Bellatrix is it is, Yashas, you can correct me if I'm wrong, but it is the third company in the world to have developed green propulsion technology for spacecraft. And it is also the first space startup to work with our space agency on co-developing technology, which I think is the way forward. And with that, I will invite Vishesh and Ashish. Vishesh, would you like to go first? Tell us a bit about yourself and your firm.
Sure, absolutely. Guys, well, firstly, thanks for having us out here. I'm representing Special Invest. We're a seed fund managing roughly $40 million of assets under management. We're a pre-seed seed investor, which typically means we invest about $500,000 or less in initial rounds. In terms of focus areas, we're focusing on deep science and technology. In that category, we do both software and hardware. On the hardware side, particularly for space, since this is more relevant for today's discussion, we've invested in three companies, a couple of them on the upstream side, one on satellite communications, one on launch, and one on the downstream side. Other than that, we have interest in robotics, we have interest in batteries, electric vehicles, in companies that are in the aviation space as well. So that's on the hardware side.
Thanks, Vishesh. Ashish, over to you.
Thanks, Susmita. Thanks very much for organizing this. My name is Ashish. I'm a partner with CrewX Ventures. We're a B2B focused early stage venture fund. Within B2B, we do, the tech enabled side and also a lot of deep tech investments. And the reason why I'm here on this panel today is because two of the young founders on the panel, Avais and Yashas, after a lot of begging and pleading, were kind enough to take our money. So, that's kind of given us a ticket to be on this platform. Excited about the next hour or so, and let's get started.
Yeah, thank you, Ashish. So between Ashish and Vishesh's firms, five space startups have received what I consider a significant amount of funding, and I think it's only going to get better from here. So Vishesh, let's start with you. I have a few questions for you. So one is, what's made Agni Cool an attractive investment option for your firm?
Right. I think when we look at companies at the stage that we look at, we're sort of looking for two very important factors, right? One is the founder market fit. Are these the kind of founders that are relevant for the business they're building and the time it takes to build these businesses? I do not think space businesses are a five-year horizon business. They're typically a 15, 25-year horizon businesses. And you essentially want founders that have the tenacity and the view and the vision for it, right? And clearly for us, Srinath and his team sort of met that criteria. The second piece was, what's fundamentally different? There are other people solving similar problems, be it launch or be it anything else in other parts of the world. And for us, when we were spending time with Agnikul prior to our investment, a lot of time went in to understand why they're doing what they're doing and what makes them fundamentally different.
Vishesh, are the regulatory hurdles for a company like theirs and even go-to-market challenges for a young rocket company?
Well, if you're a young rocket company, you pretty much have only challenges around you, right? I mean, it's not like building a software product and shipping it. At the time they took our money, of course, the regulatory environment was not as clear as it is today. And one can debate even if it's clear today or not, and I'll sit out of that. But I think, my larger view, given that we do a lot of deep science and technology at the firm, is that oftentimes the sectors we're looking at do not have regulatory clearances or clarity. And then one needs to sort of step back and see on which side of the innovation curve are you. Are you on the right side? Are you on the left side? And if you do think you're doing larger good for the ecosystem, then I think, I mean, at least our firm believes that sometimes progress precedes policy.
Yeah, no, I totally agree with you, Vishesh. And I think in that sense, Agnikul, you guys have been lucky that you have patient capital. And given where India is with its private sector, Vishesh, I agree with you. I think it's some of the things will go in tandem, and we have to push for regulatory change and reform and all of that. So it's Ashish, a couple of questions for you, since you guys have invested in Pixel and Bellatrix. What was it that you found compelling in their pitches?
So I think first up, you know, we were proactively looking at investments in space technology. You know, we had looked at a couple prior, and you know, that kind of opened our minds, opened our perspective in terms of what's available out there, you know, what are the kind of opportunities one should be pursuing. So from a timing perspective, you know, it's important that there's an investor entrepreneur connect. You know, when we're proactively looking at it, you know, that's a big filter cross, right? But you know, both Bellatrix and Pixel had very different stories, and they came to us at different stages of time, right? I mean, let me just take with Bellatrix. You know, both Yashas and Rohan, accomplished individuals, right? At a young age, you know, they've achieved a lot. I think when we invested in them, they were in the fourth year, yeah? And they had a clear body of work to showcase, right? I mean, they were working with, you know, the top space agency in India, you know, or globally. And you know, there were talks, and there was work happening to collaborate and, you know, build something together, right? So there was a lot of work already gone in, a lot of IP already created, and you know, we were kind of taken with their, you know, broad mission of I think it was a green, clean, and affordable space, right? And you know, that appealed to us, right? And you know, with the momentum in this particular sector, with so many launches happening, with across the globe people, you know, building assets in this category, you know, this was a clear short sort of an opportunity to back, right? So the body of work with the two individuals, two founders, what they'd accomplished, you know, that kind of made it easy, right? So, you know, that's one example. Pixel was a different story. You know, Avesh and Shitish came, you know, I think they were still in college, right? And, you know, but even while they were in college, while, you know, we were in college, we were doing different things, which I can't talk about right now. You know, these guys were really doing some path-breaking stuff, right? And it was amazing to see such passion, you know, such understanding of deep understanding of you know, the opportunities, and you know, we were just so excited to kind of work with these guys. And I truly say, you know, for both these guys, you know, we had to wait up, make a way in, right? It was, and I'm, you know, fortunate to be with them. And you know, I'll give an example of Pixel again. We I think connected them to one particular investor. And that investor ended up investing, sure, backing them. But you know, at the time when I kind of did the intro note, he kind of referred to, you know, this kind of reminds me of Motorola's Iridium days and stuff like that, right? And you know, the context was to say, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars will kind of get into this particular opportunity, perhaps nothing will come out, right?
Yes.
Yeah, you know, and it wasn't to say that, you know, this is an ambitious board call. It was to say maybe nothing's going to come out of this, but you know, because you're doing the introduction, let me just spend time with the guys. And after the meeting, you know, he came back, he called me broadly right after and said, you know, this is perhaps the smartest kids I've met. You know, here's a 21-year-old who can talk business and technology, you know, in so much of detail. And it's unbelievable. You know, I'm just delighted to kind of back those guys, right? And, you know, I'm sure, you know, when kind of Yashas and Rohan and Srinath and Devlina kind of go out, you know, this is what we see.
Yeah, absolutely, Ashish, I'm with you. I mean, having spent almost 12 years in California, having started a company in Europe, I think the kids we have here, I'm calling them kids because I'm much older to them. I think the kind of talent.
Call them grandkids.
Well, I mean, the kind of talent and sort of tenacity and even at such a young age, they bring to this is not only inspiring. I think if you look at their counterparts in the US, in the Valley, for example, we were talking yesterday, Ashish and I, you know, Skybox Imaging was the first space startup, so to speak, which around 2009 raised private capital in the Valley. Let's not forget that the Elon Musks of the world at the end of the day get their billions from NASA, from DOD. So it's taxpayer funds, essentially. So when Skybox raised this money, they sold themselves as a data company as opposed to space company. And it worked. And I think since then, startups there have had a better chance of raising money. And I think India is finally getting onto that journey as well. So what do you think, Ashish, will it take for a Pixel or a Bellatrix to scale?
I think the first job is, we were chatting just ahead of the opening the panel, and you asked a question to a waste to saying, is your satellite ready, right?
Yeah.
And when are you looking to launch, right? So that's the first test, right? I mean, you put one up there and, you get results and you start mapping those results, and that's your product market fit, right? And, that's the first step. Similarly for, Bellatrix, Yasha's, you've got to get your first propulsion system in there, right? Be it irrespective of the size of the satellite you're chasing or the opportunity you're chasing, you've got to demonstrate that the first one works, right? There's a lot happened in the lab, more than that, and it's going to be taken out to the real space. So that's the first step. And, for both, I truly believe that, you get the first one out there and, with client validation, customer validation, market will open up. It's a large opportunity. We keep talking about space being the next $1 trillion opportunity, right? So, there's enough out there. Yeah. So, you've got to go step by step, take baby steps in the right direction, and things will shape up.
Yeah, no, I agree with you. And I think in the audience, those of you from other sectors, from IT, from biotech, nanotech, clean tech, what have you, I think what, to me, the most exciting thing about space tech is these guys are building, and my companies have built flight hardware. So to get something to fly is not easy, as we have been hearing. It takes a good 5-7 years to say you've arrived. And when it does make it to space, it is a fantastic feeling. So I think round two, let's go on to our young entrepreneurs. I have a set of questions which will be common to all of you. So let's start with the first one. And Avais, you'll be the first one to go. Tell us about Pixel in a couple of sentences. What is it that you're building and offering, and what is your vision for the company?
Sure, thanks, Susmita. So in terms of what Pixel is doing, we are a space data company. And we have cameras on satellites that will essentially take photographs of the Earth. And once that data is beamed down, they make it easy for anyone to take this and use it in day-to-day applications in agriculture, climate, forestry, urban monitoring, and the sort. The value prop essentially is that when we started with analyzing satellite imagery that was available either open source or commercially at that point in time. But what we realized was there's a scope for beaming down a much better type of data, much better quality of data, and to do it at a rapid and inexpensive, way. And that's what we're doing, trying to democratize access to this data. And before we even started, we reached out to, organizations who were using satellite imagery in one form or the other globally, be it in the US, in Latin America, in Europe, or anywhere else. And that sort of corroborated the thesis that we had, that if we were able to beam down quality data at low cost, which enables more access to more companies in the sector, would be able to create some impact. So that's, I think, briefly what Pixel is trying to do. Beam down photographs that can help make better decisions on ground.
Excellent. Srinath, what about you? Give us a quick description of AgniCool. What is it that you're trying to offer? What's it that you're building for space?
Sure, Shishmita. So at AgniCool, we are trying to build a small rocket that can, offer dedicated launches for small satellites. So in that sense, it's a perfect segue to talk right after our waste potential customer for us. So the idea here is, I think what has happened over the last 10 years or so, satellites have shrunk, and the very manner in which satellites are used has become about, putting a bunch of small satellites together as opposed to having one satellite do the job. However, rockets, which are basically built to the sole mission of carrying satellites to space, still seem to be stuck at their own, larger sizes, at least across the world, that's how it is. So people are forced to do some sort of a ride share, and ride share is pretty much like waiting for a bus in a bus stop. Buses don't come when you want them to, and even if they come, they might be full and they don't go to where you want them to go to. And sometimes when the buses are not full, they don't even take the bus. I've seen this happen whenever I take a bus to Bangalore, at least with the buses I take, unless they're full, they don't actually leave the station. So we wanted to change all that around, said, hey, you are building a small satellite, you should be able to go to space just as easily as a large satellite would have to go to space. If we can do it in an affordable manner for both you and for us, then we are basically opening up gates to a lot of other people who want to do something in space. So the core mission was actually to not have this, if you want to go to space, the first obstacle is, hey, can I get a launch had to happen? We wanted to break that, and that should not become a big deal at all. So that is where we started building rockets now using, a couple of specific, strategies. like, you know, 3D printed rocket engines, which are, you know, one shot 3D printed where you don't have any human intervention in the making of a rocket engine. Having a customizable, you know, vehicle configuration where it's pretty much like ordering a laptop. Choose your screen size, choose your RAM, choose your hard disk, choose your graphics card. You have a laptop for you. A rocket should be like that. Choose your payload, choose your orbit, choose your launch port. You should be able to build something out of that. And then, of course, you know, being able to do it at the time frame, in the time frame that the customer wants. So that is how we are trying to do, you know, provide launch services to people. So hopefully this will open up doors to everyone, you know, to who want to go to space to do something.
Thanks, Srinath. And for those of you who are listening out there, you know, what happened to the computing industry in the 90s is starting to happen with the space industry in the last decade. What I mean by that is you can get a lot of your satellite components off the shelf. You can literally build a satellite in your lab or in your garage or in your home, actually, sometimes. And what we talked about, you know, the reconfigurability aspect. So it's becoming, in some ways, there are parallels. And you can pretty much have a small mission control on your desktop these days. And then that's the reality of how the industry has, you know, moved over the years. Devleena, let's hear you out on what is it you're offering through Numerate.
Cheers, Shushmita. Well, thanks. First of all, thank you to you and Bloom for having me in this panel. So Numerate is a geodata science company, and we are currently focused in the seafood sector. We are trying to promote feasibility, sustainability, and profitability for fisher folks. So this was started, we were, back in 2018, we were analyzing coastal flood data, and we realized the community that is mostly suffering from increased natural disasters, increased tsunamis, increased coastal flooding, is the, you know, fisheries sector. And it is not only something that was happening in India, but globally. So we went back to our drawing board and we started, designing this application, which we now call Fofish. So we have two customers. We have two types of customers. One is the fisher folks and one is the seafood buyers. A value prop to fisher folks is increased safety in the seas. We provide them high resolution marine advisory. We provide them lower cost operational data, which is 90% fuel cost. So we give them fishing advisory, which reduces the time they need to go to a certain place of fishing. So it's very efficient for them operationally. We give them easy access to financial loans, because using this is the only platform that is currently helping in digitizing, you know, fishing data, through which we're connecting them to the financial piece as well. Our value prop to our seafood consumers are the quality of seafood, an end-to-end traceability that we provide. We are doing a fish to fork model, which kind of tells every consumer where the seafood has come from. And if you're a little bit frequent with the entire seafood industry, we know traceability is being highly talked by various international organizations. The product was selected by the United Nations World Food Program because you're directly impacting SDG 2, which is Curb Against Hunger. And we also supported by the European Space Agency for addressing SDG 14 and 12. Through that, we are actually reaching out to global customers, and not in India, but through support of WFP and our global partners. We're already implementing that in many other countries, apart from just India.
Thanks, Devleena. And I think, a little note for the audience here is that when I talked about the near $400 billion space market, one of the biggest sort of slices of that pie is satellite applications for here on Earth. And I think Devleena's company is a great example of that. So there is a lot of crossover space here now between what we have in terms of space assets and how we can use them for improving life on Earth. Let's go to our next young entrepreneur. Yashas, are you ready to tell us about Bellatrix?
So basically, Bellatrix for you is a space logistics company where we deal with propulsion systems for satellites. Basically, the job of a rocket is to take a satellite to an orbit called packing orbit. You can't expect a rocket to probably take you all the way to geostationary orbit at 35,000 kilometers, for which a satellite needs to have its own onboard propulsion system. So we started out trying to solve problems with related to propulsion that is already there in the market. A couple of areas we initially identified. One is on the potential of electric propulsion over chemical propulsion. When we started out, predominantly chemical propulsion was the main system that was out there incorporated in satellites. And then we realized the amount of fuel that one needs to carry. If I take example of a 3.5-ton satellite, about 2 tons of the satellite mass is just fuel. And you pay rocket launch costs at the price of like $20,000 to $40,000 per kilogram. And you are paying all that to carry just 2 tons of fuel all the way just for your ride, right? So such a waste of money. And then we look at electric propulsion. It's a revolutionary technology according to, I mean, a lot of studies that have been taken up, and we too ourselves feel that. Basically with electric propulsion, you can probably reduce the fuel cost or the fuel volume from about 2 tons to just around less than 300 kilograms.
Wow.
So that's the kind of saving you get in terms of mass. And you could use that mass to accommodate more payload, which would in turn give you more revenue every year, or rather build a much smaller satellite, which could cost you less to build and launch. So we started out with this, and we started building something called microwave plasma thrusters. Mm-hmm. It's one of our patented technology of Bellatrix, and we have been working with ISRO on the same technology. One of the unique highlight is that we thought, why don't we replace xenon as fuel, which is very costly. The space grade xenon that flies on spacecraft costs like 6 to 9 lakhs per kilogram. We have replaced that with conventional water, the normal drinking water as fuel, which is just free. So this was our first product, and we started working with ISRO. Chairman ISRO had been, at that time, Kiran Kumar sir, had been benevolent to like support a startup and wave off a lot of all the bank guarantees, revenue backgrounds that they expect from all companies. So all those things worked out with ISRO, and then we started working with them. Eventually, we realized that having one technology as a space propulsion company would not work out for us on a long run. So there is a large market out there globally. And for us to be a global player based out of India, we thought, what could we offer to cater to the entire class of satellites? So the logical step was to become a full suite solution provider. So now today we changed our business models accordingly, started working on parallel technologies. Right from 2015, we have been working on 4 different technologies. And today we have like 4 different products. For nano satellites, we have something called nano thruster. This is probably the world's smallest thruster under development. We are very advanced now. I think pretty early next year, we are looking at flight qualification of that. So it's called nano thruster. And then for chemical propulsion, we started looking at what is there in the market. We found there is toxic and carcinogenic hydrazine based propulsion systems, which I think most of you in the panel are aware. It's very dangerous to handle, very expensive. So rather than that, we have come up with a much greener, safer alternative, which we can even handle without gloves and without masks. So it's that clean and safe, and it's not explosive. So that is our second product. We call it green propulsion. And third, for microsatellite constellations that are coming up, we started working on the perfect constellation engines. So we have come up with highly efficient miniaturized Hall thrusters, which again is something very innovative. And for bigger satellites, we have the microwave plasma thrusters. And basically in all the products, the core has been on innovation and R&D, where we are doing some products which are better than what is there.
I think this is fantastic, Yashwant. And the way you presented it to us is it's all, you know, a piece of cake. It's very simple and done. No, I think this is fantastic. So is the second offering that you mentioned the kind that ECAPS in Sweden, for example, offers?
Yes, exactly. In fact, in terms of performance, it is slightly better.
Right. No, it's quite amazing that now you guys have come quite some distance from where you guys started. And now you have 4 sort of offerings, very market-tuned, in fact. So let us take the second question for all of you, all 4 of you, and I'm going to bundle it together. So Avais, you can go first. Tell us about what kind of regulatory challenges you think you will have to face as you move along, and what kind of timescales are you looking at to turn profitable? Take those 2 questions and roll them into one.
Sure. So in terms of the regulatory hurdles, when we started out, the biggest thing was that there was no clarity on the regulatory framework, in the sense that we had to go out and get licenses to communicate from the satellite to the ground or take images. There was no clarity on how to go about taking that. The policies or the laws that were there were quite archaic, and they were never drafted for private companies. But that has changed now recently with the announcement that InSpace is going to be set up and it's going to be the one body that will take up all the regulatory challenges. I think a couple of things that would be still, you know, hurdles going ahead would be the frequency allocation for the constellation is going to be multiple satellites that would need to communicate with ground stations around the world to be able to have clarity in terms of having a national body that can interface with the ITU and everyone else to help get us those frequency allocations. To compete globally would be, you know, one thing.
There is a national body out of Delhi that you would coordinate then with ITU, isn't it? I mean,
it was supposed to be either, you know, the Ministry of Telecom or the Wireless Planning Commission, but they were never set up to do it with startups.
Yes.
But now InSpace is taking that over. They will bring in multiple different ministries and entities and do that themselves. So I think it's become better that way. The other hurdle would be, you know, if like in terms of selling the imagery that we get from the satellites, almost all the sales have to go to the National Remote Sensing Center. And that doesn't make sense in an industry where people are trying to reduce the lead time between getting these images and putting it in the hands of the customers. So to be able to compete with global companies, we would need to get it out as soon as possible. And that means we can't have government entities being there for, you know, all kinds of data. It would make sense if you do it below 50 centimeter or 30 centimeter data, which would be critical to, you know, national security. But apart from that, there should be sort of an open playground for anyone to go out and sell, because imagery of this resolution is being available globally anyway. Someone else wanting to buy this from a US company can do it easily. So an Indian company necessarily should not have a hindrance to go and sell that easily. So I think those would be the biggest regulatory hurdles that.
So Avais, let me just interrupt for a second. So you're saying as of today, you would have to go through the through NRSC in Hyderabad to download your imagery and not be able to do the download directly onto your servers. Is that what you're saying?
Not the download. So download can happen wherever we have, like we have ground stations across the world. But once they are there, when we are licensing out our data to a customer in India, then
you
it has to go
through NRSC.
Oh, and it becomes especially tougher if you are like 1 meter or below. Which is not the number we should be looking at in this day and age, because 30 centimeter digital globe imagery is available freely anywhere. So we need to be, in terms of the numbers, on par with other countries to help us on a level footing elsewhere. So I think that would be one other hurdle to go ahead on that front. In terms of turning...
What about sort of turning profitable?
Yeah, in terms of turning profitable, there's two paths that we have. One is, you know, we are building two satellites right now, one which is ready and the second one which will go up in the second half of next year. We could take it slow, sell imagery from this, you know, generate revenue and then build more and, you know, launch more and take our sweet time with it. So that's one way. If you're looking at that, then the end of 2022 would be the time where we would start looking profitable. But, you know, we have decided to take a faster approach to put as many satellites up there to cover as much globe. So that means that we're going to be always spending much more on these satellites than the rate at which we'll get in revenue. So in that case, it would be either the end of 2023 or the first quarter of 2024 where we would be looking at turning profitable. So these are the two paths that we have in front of us.
So are you running it in parallel? So are you building your satellites and launching them at the same time you are starting to chase customers? Is that happening parallelly now?
Yeah. We started to chase customers even before we started building the satellites to confirm whether they would buy, whether there are companies that would even, you know, look at taking a whiff at us and buying our data. And that has only increased. So we have a good line or a pipeline of companies waiting to have the data from space. So the first two satellites will be critical to that, and we can start selling as soon as our first satellite will be up in a few months' time. So we don't have to wait until we have the entire constellation, or wait 2 or 3 years for us to start generating revenue. If we want to, you know, take it slow and, you know, build sustainably, the first and the second satellites we're building should be enough for us to not raise any more money. But as I said, there's also a faster way to do it if you want to compete globally.
Thanks, Avais. As we move on to Srinath, Devlina and Yashas with the same question, I want to tell the audience that after this round, we'll be happy to take a question or two based on what you've heard so far. And just as a tandem to what Avais has shared with us, so your company has raised $5 million in the first round, right? Just for comparison's sake, guys, Skybox Imaging, they raised about $90 million in their first round to build exactly two demo satellites. And here you are, with that kind of money, can you build the entire constellation?
We can do four with this amount of money, but we are sticking with two for now. But yeah, it's an advantage. The time has brought us, and the location that being in India has brought us.
Cool. Let's hear you out, Srinath, about what are your regulatory issues that you deal with, and how do you plan, or how soon, in terms of time horizon, will you turn profitable, you think?
Sure. So I think on the regulatory front, and again, a lot of unanswered questions initially before the InSpace announcement came. I think all of the Indian space tech startups and private players got like a gravity assist during the Atmanirbhar announcement suddenly towards the end of May. So I think a lot of clarity already in terms of what has to be done. We've already started conversations with InSpace, and they've been very supportive in terms of, you know, connecting us to the right people and so on. So I don't see, like big questions out there. Of course, some details we'll have to, you know, probably get from InSpace or ISRO in terms of, you know, what exactly would be required before we are given permission to launch from India and so on. But that is, I think, more of a detail-oriented thing as opposed to like, okay, can we launch, and bigger questions of bigger existential questions. Those things are already taken care of. So I think on that front, I don't see too many things, after the InSpace thing that has basically been taken care of. So I'll move on to the next question, which is on profitability itself. So I think we'd probably be starting to do commercial launches starting from, say, later part of 2022 or early 2023. That is how we see our timeline playing out, probably with a few test launches before that itself. Interestingly, this business is a negative working capital business, right? At least today, the way the market works is you probably, as a launch vehicle company, you pretty much get paid at least 90 to 95% way before the launch. Of course, that could change. In fact, we wish it changes to, it may not be 6 months before launch, which is how it is today. So I think out of the first two or three launches, customers sort of would pay for a good chunk of the rocket, if not the entire rocket itself. So that profitability would probably start to happen middle of 2023, I would say, or late part of 2023. Revenue would start probably in 2022. But within the next 2 years, I think we'd be, you know, definitely in the green zone in terms of profitability.
Thanks, Srinath. Devleena, over to you. I think you are going to tell us you are already profitable, right?
Yes, we are. When I started Numerate, I really didn't have money in the bank to even have a team per se. So I started with offering data as a service, and I was lucky to find two customers who believed in me and let me build something for them. And with that, the money to the table, gather the team, and then we build the product. Profitability was not a choice for me, it was a necessity. So we have been profitable that way from day one. But our products started generating revenue early this year. And since then, we have stopped relying on our services applications, and we are focused only on products now.
No, that's fantastic. And, you're saying you essentially bootstrapped to profitability, like you solo founded it and bootstrapped to profitability in a short stretch, right? Is that what you're saying?
Correct. And I would say that, it was I learned it the hard way. My first startup, we were a bunch of techies. We had a very advanced product, and we did all that was possible from the technical perspective, but we didn't even bother to do the product market fit. And we knew how it shaped up. So even after developing a very tech edgy product, we really didn't have customers paying for it because we were very early to the market. So that taught me lessons the hard way. So from day one in Numerate, we make sure that even while building a product, even today, every feature that we release, we make sure we run a set of validations with the end customers and make sure, you know, the customers are using it, will pay for it, and they are being able to, you know, derive some value out of it. So it's kind of a continuous integration that way, and we keep it that way, and it has actually helped us.
Yeah, no, I think that's interesting because some of the others might also have faced the early to market issue, right? I mean, for example, Yashas, you guys already have a line of products you're offering. In some ways, you are also early to market, I would say, in some sense, some respects. Let's go over to Yashas, hear you out. What's your regulatory-wise, because ISRO decided to partner with you, did it make things easier? What do you see in terms of profitability, the runway to profitability for your company?
Yeah. One thing about being a satellite propulsion company is that you need not run around and get all the licenses for the satellite. So that's basically the job of a satellite manufacturer. And probably if you're launching it, that's the job of the rocket company. So we are probably not facing similar regulatory challenges as maybe Avaaz and Srinath are. But in terms of probably getting our chemical propulsion systems out to the global market, that is where it also comes under some export end user certifications. Like, for example, if you are buying certain critical products from Europe or from US, there would be some end use certifications where we sign up something to the end user and the government approves and then sells, then you will be allowed to ship the product, right? Something like that is there in India under SCOMIT. That is applicable only for chemical propulsion systems. It's not a challenge as such, but it would be better someday if things kind of move more faster within the SCOMIT body and approvals happen very quickly. Maybe within a week or so, if we get that approval, that would make ease of doing business. It would take it a notch higher. And probably in terms of profitability, we are now close to completion of product development. So next year, three of our products would be launched and tested in space.
So have, probably, have you broken even already? Because Bellatrix...
Not yet. Because space qualification is the major thing and that is spending next year. So right now, most of the money that is coming in is all going into R&D. So these are all paid pilot projects from potential customers, right? So that's all going directly into R&D. But I think in terms of profitability, that comes when we actually get launch contracts with probably or thruster contracts with foreign customers. So 2022 is the year when we start seeing major chunk. Maybe end of 2022 itself we could start.
Yeah, that sounds good. I think 2022 we all need to regroup because many of you will have broken even or even start making small profits. So just to add to what Yashin said, I remember when we helped launch SkySat, the Skybox high-resolution satellite, the 110-kilogram thing on the PSLV, and they were using ECAPS propulsion, the green propulsion. What was tricky, not difficult, but what was tricky is the process of getting the fuel to Sriharikota and actually, during the checkout integration. So that bit was something which was new to ISRO at that point, because none of the previous customers had done that.
In fact, that is the advantage of green propulsion. So with hydrazine, you have a manufacturing facility at Sriharikota. You can't transport the fuel.
Right.
Probably with ECAPS, they were able to bring it on flight.
That's right.
Yes. Yeah, that is probably the first fuel which flew on a cargo flight.
Yeah,
so
no,
that is the main advantage. Now you can even fill your fuel in the satellite and just ship it and it's ready to launch.
I think that's like fantastic. That's brilliant. So I think with that, we will take some questions. And Anirvan, I hope you can help me if you already have questions from the attendees. We can take a couple.
Sure. So the first question is from Akhil Aguirre, who's interestingly from the Telangana government. So his question is directed at all the entrepreneurs over here. What sort of help you would require from the governments and any synergies to work on potential government space tech use cases? So whoever wants to go, why don't you?
I think it's a great question, guys. Here is someone from the Telangana government asking you direct, what is it that you would want from the government for your respective businesses?
Okay, can I take this?
Yes, Yash, go ahead.
Yeah. So one thing that we might want to look at from state governments is probably land and kind of support in terms of tax incentives, maybe get space tech SEZs. And kind of provide land at least to, maybe you could even give a incentivized payment schemes where we start with a small down payment and eventually like a double or triple of rent we keep paying and eventually get some land.
How big space would you like, Yash? Just ask for it.
Yeah, that would be like different for different companies. Maybe for
Bellatrix. Oh, for yours. Yeah, how much?
Yeah, we could be looking at around 5 to 6 acres.
Okay. Well, that's a modest asking for whoever has asked the question. Avaaz, would you want to add something, Devlina,
Srinath? Yeah, no, I think in terms of like what the government can help is, you know, one is the money. It's a sector where you require money to put something up and to demonstrate something, at least in most cases, except when it's not downstream. And that can be done through existing methods. One is, you know, grants. A lot of state governments have money to be able to give out grants. and to be able to keep that aside for space tech, but more importantly, to be a customer to the companies that are doing it. If it's a space data analytics company, you know, to be able to take that, different ministries will need these inputs with space data from companies like us, to be able to use that data for you know, feeding it to the analytics companies, or even, you know, for, you know, rocket companies, if they want to launch their own satellites, to be able to you know, get a much better cadence for the data. So I think to be able to be to support in not just grants, but also to be able to do this. And this is also a sector which requires a lot of imports and exports. So as Jayesh has mentioned there, to have incentives there to be able to not pay a lot of custom duty, to be able to get that back if they're exporting and things like that, that would be helpful to have from the government.
You should also put numbers, guys. Otherwise, what kind of grant would you want from the Telangana government? Go ahead and put a number.
So I think, look, we've been in the US for about quite a few months for the accelerator. There we saw that, you know, any decent space tech startup could get up to $2 million, which is about 14 crores. We'll not ask for that, but, you know, something at least about a...
That's about a good amount to start, I think, yes. I mean, not crore, attached, yeah. $2 million is a good place to start. So anybody else wants to respond to that question? Any of the VCs? Ashish? Vishesh?
Yeah.
Devlina? Yeah, go ahead. Please.
Yeah, so there are two things about it. So one is about, you know, if a state, we, I would typically speak from the downstream perspective. So currently we have a lot of challenges accessing data. So if that data access challenges can be reduced a little bit, for example, you know, startup like me who is you know, addressing, you know, pressing business issues, for us to go by NRSA and ISRO for every data need is a very, difficult for us, and, you know, us a business race gives us a lot of time to waste, so maybe slackening that a little bit. And especially about working with the government, brought about this DIPP thing, which you, if a startup is registered, they can work with the government without having to file the tender process, but we don't really see that happening in any kind of such GIS application side of things, where, you know, maybe a GIS monitoring, even for example in my own use case, doing something on the coastal security, we see all the big players who are being able to participate in a government tender. And even though we have the technology and we have the advance, we have the proof that we have worked with them, we don't get an entry there. So some, you know, advantage should be given to new age technology, or some kind of allowance for us to do a POC at least and to showcase to them, which is very difficult for us to get. Startups like us cannot really go up to the you know, tender qualification of the amount of revenues that you need or the number of years that you need in the market. Those needs to be slackened for us to work, yeah, with a Telangana or a Orissa or a West Bengal or a thing. If those are not there, I could have easily worked with any state governments for that matter. We don't see this kind of regulations in outside India, by the way. So we are not talking about handing us the entire tender, but at least some opportunity to showcase that talent.
No, I think we hear you, Devlina. So just to kind of do a quick recap, unless Srinath, do you wanted to add something before I do a recap for this question?
No, I think all the points have been addressed.
Yeah, so I think just a quick recap, we'll go backwards. So I think Devlina made a very good point that the government tendering system is so complicated in India, and with all of these other parameters that need to be met, need to be streamlined and dropped for companies which already have products. And I think a state like Telangana, which has a big fisheries focus as well, should be able to have a separate channel for startups, if you ask me. Why should they go through the same process as big companies or, you know, others are? And I think the need for land, and an SCC kind of setup, not far from where the base is. Like, for example, not too far from, say, Bangalore or Chennai or wherever the operations are, would be great. And then grants. I think the United States, one of the best things is every year, NASA gives out, I mean, this year I know for a fact that NASA gave out almost $15 billion to about 232 small companies. No strings attached. So you can get up to $100,000 to prove your technology. And phase two, you can get up to $500,000 to commercialize your technology. I mean, those kind of grants we need for our young entrepreneurs. So I think between all of you, we have a few things covered. Any other question maybe before we move on to the
ahead. One really interesting question, and I think it cannot be more relevant for anyone but Awaz as well as Devlina. So how do you see the integration of cloud computing and space tech? So that's quite an interesting question. Awaz, why don't you go first?
So I think, space is the next turf where the big four companies are going to compete. You know, if you look at Google or Amazon or even Microsoft now, everyone's coming up with Azure Space or, you know, AWS Space. They started with ground stations and they're now moving to a more wider part. So I think the good thing is that helps open up a lot of access to the startups in terms of the infrastructure that they would have needed to build. Just taking the case of Azure Space that recently came up, it makes it much easier for us to integrate with any ground stations across the world, and it gives us a clarity in terms of what it's going to cost us. And they're also bringing in different things like, you know, a marketplace. They have different partners that we can work with. For example, KSAT is a ground station company based out of Norway, which has been doing this for decades now. And by their partnership with Microsoft, it helps open them up to any startup and makes it, you know, cost affordable for an early stage startup to be able to do this. So it's a good thing that, you know, like when you see these big companies taking a leap of faith and putting confidence in a sector like this, it gives confidence to investors, which sort of creates a trickle down effect into more investment flowing into the space, as well as setting up that infrastructure that would require a lot of capital expenses in the first place, which you would not have to spend. And the fact is they're like open to working in multiple different ways, all these big companies, be it Microsoft or Amazon or Google. Google acquired Skybox and made it do terrible as you would know. I think it's a very positive thing that's happening. That's from my side.
Yeah, Devrina, over to you.
Yeah, this is interesting because, you know, we have been having word with both ISRO and INCOIS for creating a geospatial cloud just for the Indian, satellite data. I believe, and what we have seen that ISRO and NRSC are very, they're closed systems. So they typically question about having the data available in other public clouds. So given that sense of security, they can always come up with an Indian geospatial cloud. And it's easier for us, companies like us, who are current, you know, we use data for everything. So it is very vital for the kind of applications that we use. And we have been requesting in various forums to have a cloud access so we can have data as a service. And not only that, not for the regular day-to-day cloud, but also opening up historical data so that we can train our own our models on it. Which I believe can be, given to us. I don't see a reason for that. That has been a long request. If anybody in this panel or in the guests can help us do that, it will definitely help us.
So Devrina, how come you haven't approached any of the big IT firms in India to discuss this cloud approach as opposed to ISRO and NRSC?
No, we do. We actually currently we are using AWS for all our cloud-based accesses. So we do have a go-around for it. We are not stuck at it. But the reason we kind of ended up there is because there was no easy way of accessing NRSC and ISRO. And one more thing, other thing that I would like to, since we are discussing this topic, typically in Europe, you see, and even in the US, there are various license or, you know, public distributors of NASA and ESA data, which are validated distributors who kind of distribute data downstream. So I don't know why we cannot build something of the sort. If ISRO and NRC wants to censor some data and just distribute the rest of it, be it be so. But at least have some channels there where we don't have to approach NRC or ISRO for every time we need data access. I believe they have better things to do in life than look up at a startup application and, you know, give them data access. So yeah. If you can at least have a, you know, filter there, it will be easy, make both of our lives easier.
Yeah, I think that's been a big concern for most analytics players in India. And also Avais brought that up. I think having to go through ISRO and NRSC every single time and how slow they are to respond is a big, big bottleneck. And we need to grow up as a country in terms of our regulatory policies around geospatial data. I mean, the other countries are already at the frontier and we are just getting started. So I think I hear that. Let's go on to the next round where I'd like to talk to Ashish and Vishesh a little bit about a few different things. Let's start with same question for both of you, Ashish and Vishesh. Does innovation matter more to a VC or scale and why?
Ashish, do you want to go first?
Go ahead.
Yeah, sure. So I think a good question. The answer is depending on which VC you want to ask and, you know, what sort of capital they're managing and what their strategy is, right? I think to someone like me, who's pretty much coming in as a first institutional check, to me, innovation matters a lot more than scale to begin with. And to some extent, I'd like to go out on a limb and say that it possibly precedes scale. I mean, I got to be able to innovate to put something out and then think of scaling that. Of course, one wants to have a vision to make sure that you're not doing something that's one trick pony or just something that you're innovating that you can't scale. You ought to be able to do that as well. But I would worry less about scale upfront than saying, why do I need to exist?
Ashish, your take on the matter?
No, I think answer similar. I think our investment philosophy is very similar to Vishesh's Vishale. The only thing I will add here is, innovation is paramount. And I think that's what kind of gets us going with the entrepreneurs to kind of check. But I think we need a perspective on scale, right? Just an innovative product with no market large enough to kind of build something of significance, that doesn't work, right? For anybody, be it the founder, be it the investor, whatever, right? So I think you gotta have that big picture perspective, and at the core, at the foundation, is gonna be something very innovative. Yeah.
The second question again to the two of you would be: we have now finally arrived at a place in terms of our Indian startup landscape, where companies like the ones we have today here on the panel have been able to raise $3 to $5 million in their early rounds. So what else would the VC ecosystem like to see happen before they are comfortable in investing, say, 10 times that amount or more? So Ashish, do you want to take that first and then maybe Vishal?
Sure. We're hoping that, you ask them the question around profitability. If they're talking about turning profitable in 2022, maybe they don't need that 10x capital, right? They'll just bootstrap with the 3 to 5 million, create something of significance. But, I think the real answer is, we've seen it across all sectors, right? And India as an ecosystem is still very nascent. We are behind, right? And, the good thing here is that there are deep tech ventures who are kind of coming in and putting the $3 to $5 million checks and supporting ventures at early stage, right? It was non-existent maybe 2-3 years ago, right? So I think that's a fundamental change, and it's a matter of time that the larger VCs will start, or the corporates, I think this is a great place for the corporates to participate, will start cutting bigger checks. But like what we've seen in other sectors, and I think it's going to be very international, it's a global market at the end. And, the big checks will come from people outside, more established names, people who kind of done this before, people who have this risk appetite to kind of back ventures of this nature. And I think that's where the capital will come from, right? I mean, none of the founders here are kind of building a truly Indian product. These are all global use cases, and, they will kind of cater to, clients all across, right? So, it's a flat world, and, you go out and raise capital from the best available out there. Why restrict to India? Why restrict to funds in India? Yeah.
Vishesh, what do you think?
Yeah, no, I think I'd like to believe that. I think there's a greater probability you'll find investors from other parts of the world. Maybe from parts of the world where you don't have some of these technologies already, maybe parts of Southeast Asia, to sort of come in and move. But I think I'll get to the second part of your question, which is, what do you think they want to be seeing? I think with $3 to $5 million, if all of these people can start showing some customers and some semblance of a product out there, I think that's a good validation to then go back and show the product working, right?
Yeah.
I think you asked about innovation and scale. I think you'll get your first few dollars on innovation, but clearly the next one's going to come on scale. So everybody on this call possibly has now the onus to get past the innovation and start showing some semblance of scale before you get your next money.
Yeah, okay. And between the two of you, I wanted some insights into what, I'm assuming that both of you have a fair understanding of the initial reforms that the government has announced through InSpace. So the audience out there, InSpace is a new body that the government has decided to set up. It is in the process of being set up, which will enable promotion, regulatory approvals, and a bunch of other things which were being bottlenecked because every time you had to go through ISRO or one of the ISRO centers. So these are recent announcements with the long-term objective being privatization, right? So both of you, Vishesh, maybe you take that first. The reforms, do you think they are enough, or do you have any concerns the way they have been structured under the Department of Space? Anything, given your worldview on the matter, what would you want?
Space is a complex business. It more than me. We're talking about sending things to places that don't belong to us to do things here. So it's never going to be straightforward. It's never going to be simple, and it's never going to be adequate. But I think I'm going to take a positive note that at least now there's a certain amount of recognition that private players can participate, right? And to what length and what depth and what the issues are, I think those are battles that are worth fighting for. That's my view to it.
Fair. I think, Ashish, what's your take? Are you, you think the reforms are, I mean, any concerns around what they're trying to set up or when you compare it to other sectors, for example?
I think I want to say that, I'm sure it's true for Vishesh as well. We made these investments, prior to all these reforms or policies coming into play, right? So even without these, we're bullish about what the teams are doing and what the capability and the potential of this sector is. And, it's a bonus in a way to say that, the government's taking a proactive approach to open up and collaborate with young entrepreneurs, private enterprises. And whatever comes out of it will hopefully be good. It will take its own time. The sector is evolving. Nobody knows. Nobody's got all the answers. And this is a 5, 10, 15 year plan before good things happen, where government and private are really working together to kind of get things going, right? So it's a step in the right direction. In the short term, am I expecting any benefits? The answer is a plain no. Yeah. And I think you've got to just kind of work with your own resources, tap into your global network and build something of significance.
No, I think to me, this sounds really positive. So all the young guys on the panel who have, received investments from you guys, I think the fact that both of you as sort of representing the VC community who is willing to take that risk and invest in space companies in India, we're not even waiting for the government to announce the reforms, or that's just like you said, it came along well and good, but you think they have the promise and they have the tenacity, they have the technology. So you are convinced that it's a good place to invest. So I think that's great to have that confidence. And in that sense, I think India is now in a much better place than it was 10 years ago, if you ask me. So round 5, we are going to wrap up now because we've just sort of crossed the 1 hour mark. Just for fun, I thought let's have a rapid fire round. Each person gets 10 seconds to answer these 5 questions quickly. So let's start with Ashish, since you were the last person to be on this on the other end. So first question, 3 important characteristics for a successful entrepreneur, 3 words.
I think ability to think big and execute well. I think, be a good human, ability to attract talent, retain talent, work with teams. Right.
Okay.
That's what I would say.
So, what do you value most? Scale, innovation, impact, in what order of priority?
I think I answered that. But impact wasn't there. So, I think impact is a big parameter in my mind, personal mind. And, after that, innovation and then scale.
And who inspires you, if any of these, Sarabhai, Kalam, Musk, Bezos, Sagan, or someone else?
These are big names, but I draw my inspiration with people on the panel. Whenever I get the chance to spend time with young entrepreneurs, there's a lot to learn.
I love that answer. Yeah. Two thumbs up to that. Are the single biggest threat to humankind from a space perspective, planetary?
It's us humans again.
Okay. The question is, if you had a free ticket to travel to space, where would you go and what would you do?
Is it before these guys on the panel have it, or before Musk, before everybody else, or am I? When is this happening?
All of those constraints, free ticket.
No. If it's early days, it's happening. Me going up there makes no sense. I'm a lousy accountant. Looking out of the window, I'll get nothing out of it. So it's about finding the right guy who can just kind of make use of the opportunity. I'll run a challenge, run a charity event or something, and do something with it. Yeah.
Cool. Well, I think you might still want to consider the moon. You get to
see right. I see it from here. That's good enough for me.
All right. Let's go on to Vishesh. Vishesh, 3 most important characteristics for an entrepreneur to be successful.
Well, I think it's. I'd like to keep it to 2. It's nerve and tenacity. You're leading a very ambiguous life, so you need to be able to just deal with the situation.
Great. And scale, innovation, impact, what order?
I'm increasingly looking at a world where innovation and impact go hand in hand. So I'll put innovation first and impact and scale.
Cool. Who inspires you, broadly speaking?
Well, I'll love the answer that Ashish gave. So I don't think I can get a better one than that. Okay, I'm gonna just cut copy paste that.
Cool. I'm ready to retire with these kind of guys. I mean, I really have nothing more to do. The single biggest threat to humankind, planetary perspective on things.
Yeah, I think it's just us. We're doing crazy things on planet Earth. Now we need to find another place.
Okay. No, I was hoping someone would say Starlink by Elon Musk, but anyway.
Elon Musk is human too, right? So we end up doing crazy things out here and around here. Yeah, we'll see some debris activity soon. I'm just praying not, but...
Yeah, there is, for the audience out there, space debris in low Earth orbit is becoming a huge problem. We have about 34,000 trackable objects the size of 10 centimeters or bigger, and almost 130 million man-made objects, every object in low Earth orbit, which we don't talk about. So I think it's as big a problem as climate change. If you had a free ticket, Vishesh, where would you go? Don't tell me.
Yeah, I actually wouldn't go too far. I'd possibly just go 200 kilometers up, see the curvature and come back. I don't think I can withstand beyond that.
So Branson can take care of that, I think, in a couple of years.
Yeah, I'm hoping so.
All right. So now all of you guys, maybe Devrina will take you first on this. Three important characteristics to be a successful entrepreneur.
I believe it's a risk appetite. It's a sense of business models and being comfortable with the ambition.
Okay, and what do you value most as an entrepreneur? Scale, innovation, impact, or what order in those three?
Yeah, so keeping scale always in mind, I'll go with impact, innovation, and the scale should be, we'll define your model, but impact, innovation, and then focus on scale.
And who inspires you? I mean, every day you can have a new inspiration, but...
Well, I saw your list. I believe in that list, Carl Sagan was, I was introduced to him at a very early age. So he was the first and then rest, all of them came later.
Okay, that's very sweet because I don't find very many young people who take Carl Sagan as an inspiration. It's, I think I'm encouraged. There's hope for the world. And what about the single biggest threat to humankind, you think?
Humankind ourselves, we ourselves.
Okay, and if you had a free ticket to go somewhere,
I think I'll go to Betelgeuse. I'm a big fan of Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy and, hoping just to see the planet with my own eyes.
Yes, and I think Betelgeuse is starting to dim a little, isn't it? That's what I was reading. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, I should reach there before that happens, yeah.
Cool. Yash, you next. Three important characteristics to be a successful entrepreneur.
Probably gritty, then self-driven, and probably sensible.
Sensible, I like that. Okay. I think we'll now take across the board. So, Avais, three important characteristics?
I think that would be quick decision-making, execution, and persistence. You need to just keep at it and knock as many doors as you want. So, persistence would be big.
Srinath, same question for you.
Optimism, passion for what you're doing, and perseverance.
Okay, so perseverance is sort of everybody, the tenacity, the perseverance, you have to have that. What do you value most, you guys, scale, innovation, impact, or in what order of things? Srinath?
Impact. Go ahead, Srinath.
Oh, okay, Avais, go ahead. Impact.
Impact, innovation, and scale. It has to create positive impact first and foremost. It has to be innovative and then scale, yeah.
Same and now I know why the VCs are all inspired by you guys. I think this sounds good to me too. Okay, what about you, Srinath and Yash?
Same, impact, innovation, scale in that order, yes.
Jeez.
Impact and then probably innovation, scale in the same order.
Wow, okay. So I think we are in good hands. Who inspires you guys? Go the same order again. Avais?
So I think my answer would be Isaac Asimov. I am a big science fiction fan and a lot of ideas in terms of what I would want to do come from there, his foundation series and all that. So Carl Sagan I would have answered, but it was already taken, so I would go with Isaac Asimov.
Okay, I think Asimov is fantastic. For those of you in the audience, if you haven't read Asimov, please do. Yash and Srinath, who inspired you?
Irrespective of the industry, right? I'm more passionate at people building stuff. So maybe looking at the devil and how DRDO was brought up, Abdul Kalam sir, and probably today's government, probably I would even respect our current PM.
Okay, what about you, Srinath?
I would pick Einstein. It's I think the first principles thinking sort of started with him. Now everyone is talking about it, but I think, yeah, so Einstein.
Okay, cool. The single biggest threat to humankind, the three of you, same order. Avais, okay. What do you think is the single biggest threat?
So I think the single biggest threat is anything that curtails the progress that humankind will make. Like, we have always found a way to overcome any problem that's there. So anything that doesn't curtail the progress of humankind to figure out problems, I think that's the biggest.
That's a wise one. Okay, Yash, what do you say?
Probably the next killing virus.
Okay, Srinath, what about you?
Yeah, our actions, I think neglecting climate change as a serious topic could be a really bad thing to do.
And the last question, if you guys had a free ticket to ride to space, where and why would you go? Avais?
I would go to the center of the solar system, the center of the Milky Way, where there's a huge supermassive black hole. Again, Interstellar is a favorite movie, and you know, to be able to see how things change as we move closer would be fun.
Super. Yash, what about you?
Well, we named Bellatrix after the star Bellatrix, thinking we want to be an advanced propulsion system company. Maybe decades from now, we build a system that could go out to stars. We want to first go to Bellatrix.
Okay. All right. I had forgotten the name of your company represents a star. What about you, Srinath?
It'll be one of Jupiter's moons, actually. Grew up reading
Earth. Io or the Europa, or which one?
Io.
Io. Okay, yeah. I like Io too. I think that would be a good one to go to. And I think with that, we will wrap our panel with this question, and to our panelists, but we'll take questions from the audience. Maybe Anirvan, you could take over.
Yeah, so we've covered most of the questions. Just there's one or two questions left. One question is directed to Srinath. I'm not sure if you can answer it, Srinath. It comes from an Agnikul fan. And the question is, when can we expect our first launch?
Sure
if you can answer it.
The buildup was a little scary. sometime in 2022 for sure. Okay. Probably middle of 2022.
Fantastic. There's one more question, probably it's best answered by the VCs. Which subsector within space has the highest market potential by 2025 in India? And the options that they've given is commercial satellite launch services, rocket manufacture, which is launch vehicles, and satellite and remote sensing, which again, probably you can just pick from your own idea.
Should I take that? Yeah,
go ahead.
So I think 2025, you possibly need to be forward looking. I'd skip from picking any of those. I think debris management will be a big problem by then. So building the space situational awareness may be a bigger problem to deal with.
Well, what about you, Ashish? What do you think?
So, I agree with Vishesh, but I think 2025 is when we're probably seeing mainstream applications of everything which is in play, right? And I think that will open up a bunch of opportunities to kind of support those initiatives across the areas which have been targeted, right? And as you scale up, the problem articulated by Vishesh is obviously very relevant.
Fantastic. And I think there's a question from from someone from IT who claims to be a complete newbie to the space sector, looking for suggestions or resources to read about space tech and develop some understanding. Probably, I guess, Srinath, since you belong to a different sector and you found your way into space tech and probably one of the most interesting startups in India, why don't you answer that question? Because it would have been a great, it's a very steep learning curve for you.
He's an aerospace guy, Anirvan, you forgot.
Beg your pardon?
He's an insider, he's an aerospace fellow.
Fair.
But go ahead,
I was an aerospace enthusiast, Anirvan, so I was watching rocket launches on DD and so on. I mean, I went into finance, but my heart was sort of in aerospace.
I agree.
I think now with you could just literally start off by Googling YouTube on what is going on in space. I don't have any specific resources because I was actually following pretty much what at least the companies I knew were doing, like the ISRO and SpaceX and so on. But there are a lot of blogs being written about what is happening in space tech. So I would just start off there and keep it simple and first understand the different sectors. And then after that, if there is a particular area that is interesting for that person who asked the question, he or she could start from there and go on.
But yeah, I would just add, so broadly speaking, space would involve everything from rockets to satellites to applications to ground equipment. It also includes space science and exploration, both robotic and human exploration. So the person who has asked the question really needs to choose what is it that interests him. And like Srinath said, there's a lot of stuff available on the web to get started.
So I think we've covered all the questions. Thank you very much.
Is there anything any of you guys might want to add, which we didn't cover in audience questions or my questions before we sign off? Anybody? Or it's been long enough?
And I think on just on the resources on the internet part, like be it from my Hyperloop experience or even the Pixel experience, none of us did a degree in the things that we are doing. So all that we learned came from the internet. And it's not just the theses or the research papers that are there. It's also the access that it gives you to experts in the field. Like you can through LinkedIn or mail, reach out to just any expert anywhere in the world, be it in India or globally, and just talk to them and get an understanding. So I think that's like just be shameless about it. That's really helped us.
Great. So I think with that, Anirvan, if you like, we could conclude the panel. And thank you, everyone. I really enjoyed this. I hope it was fun for you guys as well. Anirvan, over to you.
I think it was a fabulous discussion. And Sushmita, really appreciate you taking the time to structure it in this manner. I think it's been a fabulous discussion. And thank you, everyone, for taking the time to attend this. And we'll be continuing with a few other sessions. Would love it if you guys can join. So this has been organized by India Deep Tech, which is essentially a platform that we've created, which involves all the stakeholders within the deep tech ecosystem, whether it's the entrepreneurs, the VCs, the corporates, institutes, as well as incubators. So the idea of this program is to create a deep tech ecosystem that is conducive to entrepreneurs to build over here. Because if you think about the global ecosystem of deep tech, close to 30% of unicorns are deep tech unicorns. And if you think about the VC ecosystem that was built, it was built on the back of deep tech. But unfortunately, India has probably zilch. Gray Orange might get there at some point in time. So the objective is to build a deep tech ecosystem. And we'll be having many more sessions from here on. We've done one on industrial AI. Now we have space tech. Probably we can have one more on space tech, and we follow it up with different deep tech topics. So please stay tuned, and we'll keep sharing updates on Twitter. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys. Thank you very much.
Thank you, everybody.
Hey, guys. Thanks for having us. Cheers.
Thank you. Bye.